Hallo zusammen. Wir sind hier im Workshop von Digital Courage, digitaler Klassenraum, so geht freie Software für Schulen. Wir starten ein bisschen mit Verspätung, weil wir nämlich heute ganz tolle Referenten
haben. Okay, hello and welcome. We'll be starting a bit late because we have wonderful presenters here who just needed to get themselves set up, and I'll just tell you briefly what we are talking about the next 3 hours. Lena, Simon and I, myself, we will introduce the work of Digital Courage so that you know where you are and what we are doing about digital education. And we'll hear a short presentation by Professor Langhaus about Big Blue Button, and then we talk about Moodle with Stefan Lipke. And then we will show you Nextcloud with from Baden-Württemberg. And at 13:15, roughly, Silvia Lange will present Jupiter. And then it's about Freifunk for Schools with Frank Schiebel. And just shortly before 2, if everything goes to plan, then Oliver Albrecht will show you a short software project that was created during the federal hackathon. And then there are a few words about Julian Dorn, about software, the administration, school administration. And if there were some teachers here, maybe you were at the regular meeting of teachers, and Julian, who has organized that meeting, is also here today and is going to say a few words later on. And I will now hello. I'm so glad that this presentation can take place here. Jesse and I did work together. Jesse and I worked together about education in the previous months, and we are working at Digital Courage in Bielefeld. And the question is, who is Digital Courage? And I have this slide here. Digital Courage is a club that society that for more than 30 years now is working in this about these topics about internet things and communications and so on. And we really are part of these pioneers that people are talking about. And we have a different approach here. It doesn't have to be, not everything has to be digital. And we really like digital stuff and we enjoy technology, but the world, this completely technologicalized, digitalized world, shall still be worth living. And so we can live in a good digital world, and building frameworks is very important to us. Oh, the stream is not working for me.
Wie muss denn ein Rahmen beschaffen sein, damit die Inhalte, die darin entstehen und die darin auch gut werden? Das haben wir nämlich festgestellt.
So there are big differences in digitalization, and so it is the same thing with our education campaign, that we had to ask ourselves the question, how is the framework going to have to be for digital education, so that we get a good result in the end, in the heads of the children, in the minds of the children. Digital Courage is an NGO, a non-profit NGO, and completely funded by donations, which makes us independent. And that is very important, that we are independent, because we have to distance ourselves from these demonstrations that really talk about about freedom and liberty, and that means something entirely different than we do. And we, freedom is very important for us, because we have these demonstrations, freedom instead of fear, because we don't like surveillance, but we have distanced ourselves from these so-called freedom demonstrations. And sometimes we may lose the one supporter or another, but this independence and our attitude, and we can afford that just because we are not just supported by one big benefactor, but we really get lots of get funds from lots of small donators, and so then we can risk to lose or to anger one or two people. And on the other hand, we have lots of people that really have supported us for years and read our newsletter, and we really want to give information to them. And we have small clubs in subsidiaries in several cities, and we have free and also paid employees, and work together for this world worth living in a digital age. We have our headquarters in Bielefeld, but we have some subsidiaries in other cities all over the country. I am in Berlin at the moment, and so that's we have several topics, and sometimes we try to do that with humor and with charm, and we really want to criticize the digitalization, but also with fun. And we are not against technology, we're not Luddites, and so. And yeah, the education working group is important, right? We have been working with digital education, and not just now, since everything is about remote teaching.
How can you do reasonable concepts which are appealing to people? And we noticed that the leading of the school, they're on their own, they don't know what to do, but they have to decide things. Those are the teachers who are in the classroom with a bunch of children, and they don't know what to use and how to use it. And those are the parents, who are annoyed when they see what software has been used in the classroom, and the students, but also the politicians. We have watched this for a while, and we saw a lot of things go wrong, and there are wrong assumptions. The digitalization in schools is very behind and internationally compared. It's about quantity, not about quantity, but quality. We wanna have it sustainable and complete with open concepts, with free material. We want them to learn to deal with all products, not only click colorful icons, and not only deal with Microsoft software, but also with free software. And this should be sustainable. And yeah, we want to teach the values of so that people get in touch via education with those possibilities, so they can deal with that. And independently from what politicians are saying, government of schools, and they don't know what to do. They have to do something now, but they don't get the support what they need. That's why we decided we take all the knowledge we collected in the past, and we create a Digital Courage education packet for the audience I just mentioned. We developed ideas how we imagine digital education. And so we came up with 10 rules how school can be developed. And those items are about educational material and about software, which software should be used. And this workshop, which has been created, so we took the part which is about free software and want to show you here what the possibilities are. And the educational package can be ordered from us and can be delivered to the schools. And just, just order this and start with your school.
Mit ein paar wichtigen Informationen aus und aktive Informationen eben
bring this information to your let your local politicians know as well.
Wenn jeder klein anfängt, dann
if there's something big coming out of it, then we can deliver a lot of information to a lot of schools which are lacking right now. So we are at the Congress right now. We have stickers, of course. We would have liked to put it into a collected box, but we could. That's not possible. But you can order those stickers in our Digital Courage shop. And here you see some examples. Those are the topics we really like doing. The link you see in the stickers, that's how you can find the stickers and you find your way to the shop too. Yeah, how you can see and those examples, we try to address a big audience, and so I'm interested in the digital education of children. That's something parents should be interested in, and we would be interested, and parents would say that since they're interested in their children's education, they don't want that their private data is stored in. So they see the problems and they want to do something about it. We won't have school IT being free. And that's why we do this workshop here. So to raise understanding that there are so many possibilities to use free software, but a lot of people don't know those, and this is a problem right now. And another big problem is that the schools, they just put give one person the responsibility and they deal with the whole administration of schools. The school, and sometimes it's better, sometimes it's worse, and that's why it was about that computers have to be supported as well. And if you have an institution like a school and which has a lot of computers for the classrooms and smartphones too, and then you need a professional person doing this, and that's something we want to raise awareness. So we want to distribute the resources in a better way, so the people who are doing administration and but also social workers at schools should be supported. So we don't want the social workers being responsible for media education, but and also it's lacking education in this area to educate the social workers and educators. So we have a lot of people, so there are not those positions at schools to deal with that. So there are things to do about changing their structures. I don't want to say much more. Maybe something. How you can join us. If you want to spread the idea about the package, then
dann könnt ihr das
then order the package in our shop and deliver it at your school or give it to your local politicians. You can also fund us, our club, and Digital Courage. It's sponsored, it's funded. We also deliver packages to organizations and institutions.
Kultusministerien haben beispielsweise alle schon ein Paket bekommen. GEW, also sämtliche Institutionen im Bildungsbereich. Und damit wir uns das auch leisten können, freuen wir uns über Spenden.
So the third way to support us, or the idea, is to distribute the package via mail, and we have a basic version of the education package as a free PDF. There are no books and flyers and in there, of course, but lots of information and, of course, hints where you can order the brochures and the flyers. And if you're using social networks, of course, you can use the hashtags Digitale Bildung and Bildungspaket and spread the word. Yes, I would add to that, because I had a workshop yesterday at the Hexen, where it was about IT security and domestic violence, and there was a question about wasn't prevention a lot better and education, wouldn't that be a lot better than counsel the people who had bad things happen to them afterwards? And of course I could agree, but it doesn't work like that, because people, of course, they only come to us, and I'm a counselor in that area, and the people only come to us when they are affected. And of course it has become very clear how important it is that finally, in the end, I'm waiting for that since I was at school, that this topic is becomes important at schools for 20 years now or so. But as a society, we have made a big mistake, I want to say, as a society, because we from computers, we think about in the way that if you click here, then something like this happens, and never thought on the level of how should it be created and what are the consequences and how should I think about this. As an example, if you are lucky enough to learn how to work with an Office program, then people tell you this is Microsoft Word, and so you create a file like this, and here's a text, and you make boldface and italics, and this is how you print. But learning that there are other programs other than Microsoft Word, and there are other formats besides DocX, and what are the consequences if I send a DocX to someone else, and why does it look strange because they don't want to use Microsoft products, and why could it be useful to use something else? And I don't really have to talk about that too much, but these questions are never talked about since the 1990s, and I was in such courses as a youth, and it has never been talked about, and the whole generation could use to not asking these questions, and that just makes it more difficult to educate people and to think about prevention if it's about digital violence. And this can't go on like this. It's important that something changes here, and this is the deep motivation from which we came when we said we need something we can give to people so they don't all go into the iPad classes. Oh, great, we buy lots of iPads, and that they don't walk into this trap, and so that they understand what they do to our children and our society. Okay, that's what I wanted to say. My core topic is digital self-determination and how do we have to approach these topics so that we can decide for ourselves how we do digitalization. That's what Jessica meant when she talked about sustainability, using devices that you can update for longer than 2 years, so that sustainability also means that if we don't have talk about a single program, a single application, but also tell people that and how to approach software and a computer and how to ask questions about it and how to assess it critically and see, I want to use this feature, but I don't want to use this other feature, because that's information that goes beyond explaining just how to use a certain program. And then maybe slowly we should go to the next speaker. Okay, the next speaker is Ralf Lankow from the University of Offenburg, and he will talk about Big Blue Button. Okay, I will share my window. The microphone, yes, you should hear and see it now. Everything's fine, yes.
Alles perfekt, okay.
This is not a university, it's a Hochschule. It doesn't really make a big difference. I am graphics designer and a pedagogue, and I create digital content since the 90s and have been doing web design since the 90s, but I also have been teaching since 1985 with the classical analog but also digital technology. And this is the background behind what I will want to show you now about Big Blue Button. This is not the technology itself, but the view from me as an educator who has been working with digital technologies for 30 years and 20 years as a remote teacher, and now in the second Corona semester completely online. And there have been some things, and I should tell you what our college is offering in the campus IT. The first is a URL that I should use, so Offenburg, hsoffenburg.zoom.us, and that's the code then afterward. And I think it's clear that from campus IT, it's clear that you can't really work with this because according to the Cloud Act, all the data belongs to the and can be accessed by US administration and US agencies, and that's the US Cloud Act, and then all the data have to be given to the federal and state administration and have to give them to the intelligence agencies as well. And this is the situation we have at our colleges and universities. We have to work with software which does not conform to the data protection regulation. And I'm one of the few colleagues here in Offenburg experimenting with different video tools, Jitsi and Big Blue Button. And the focus today is on Big Blue Button, because this tool is for teachers and educators at schools and universities and colleges, has a few features that are especially important for creating education and teaching material. It is an audio-video chat video conferencing tool. It has a whiteboard feature, and you can't just show presentations, but you can write directly, or you can just do work on the same board interactively with your students, and of course you can upload presentations and documents. You can make easy questionnaires in between, and that's what we all see in these video conferences, which have become necessary right now, that the presentation is being shown, but we don't have a real opponent to sparring partner to talk to. And after some time, the attention is reduced.
Zu ermöglichen, Rückfragen zu ermöglichen, Umfragen zu ermöglichen, in einer einfachen Form ja und nein oder ABCDE antworten.
Those are the things which are interesting for the classroom, and that's why we also have group rooms. And in this short presentation, I want to focus on those things from educational perspective. We focus on those rooms, and that is, makes our work more easy, seeing the circumstances right now. Big Blue Button doesn't have a lot of hurdles. With every current browser, you can run it. It's running completely and pretty well in all the actual browsers, current browsers, and also from Mac users on Safari, you can get the audio and the mics are working, and it is sufficient for the users. And yeah, the person giving the talk needs a microphone. The presenter should have a camera. That is not necessary for everybody joining the meeting.
Der entscheidende Punkt ist aber das, was ich Ihnen und euch auch vorstellen möchte, läuft hier.
Yeah, that's how it looks like, how you see it, if you're going to create a room.
Nicht unterstützt Gast bei Senfcall.
There were three students
aus Karlsruhe und Darmstadt zusammen mit dem Chaos
ran the Chaos Computer Club in Darmstadt.
Das Motto, es gibt dann Senf dazu.
And I contacted them, and they created an account for me.
Eingerichtet.
And what you see here is the step. In the starting room, where I run my events on. The second one is Team, and it's configured a little differently. It is for my employees here and assistants. And the third one is for certain meetings where I have to take note on who's there.
Und das erlaubt mir,
and the room settings let me do that. I can mute people. The access code I can change. And if you if you deal with administrational offices, that is important.
Da schreibt jemand, der kann die aktuellen Folien nicht sehen.
Somebody cannot see the slides.
Sehe gerade auch die Folien, die sind etwas verschwommen, aber sie sind da.
Ah, okay.
Ah, ja.
Aber gut. Ach so, das ist, ich kann
so I'm increasing the quality.
Aber
the important point here is.
Kann ich gerade machen, Moment. Dann kriegt ihr vielleicht ein etwas besseres Video. So.
Maybe now it works.
Vielleicht klappt es.
I can set up a waiting room and set up rooms where I can let the students give access. But with Team Room, I can create rooms where I don't have to be there. With the students' rooms, I have to start the room, and only then the students can join and assign. For the other room, I can create a checkpoint,
but und bei dem Teamraum
for the team room,
der auch zum Beispiel für mein
the,
Team
the room ist, is for my team, and I don't have to be there. There's this one level, the tool, that's why the tool is interesting to me, because I can set up the permissions the people joining the room have.
Räume freigeben kann, in dem Fall für mein
for
Team.
The students,
für die Studierenden selbst oder
they
Schüler,
only need the room number and the code, and they have to turn off their microphone.
Gleichzeitig rascheln und essen und Chips essen oder sonst irgendwas.
Was yeah, they also should do an echo test, testing their technology. Yeah, testing their camera and their microphone. Then you see the desktop.
Tools auch zu sehen ist,
For giving a lesson, then you can, there's a whiteboard important. I can upload a presentation as well, but I can here type texts or and I can draw on presentations and I can draw freely too. And those are the options which are really interesting. Also, going and doing interaction and ask questions. Things you know from the regular classroom, you can do here similarly, but with the restriction that it works better with smaller rooms, groups than bigger groups. This is their landing page, the URL you see, where I took the screenshot from. It was a talk about Moodle. The second interesting aspect is the integration with Moodle, that you can join or connect those tools very well. I don't get into the details, but I want to focus on one further aspect,
weil die Dinge unter der URL,
you can see that when you open the URL, but the second point is the breakout rooms.
Das heißt, dass ich
after I presented a topic and gave instructions, I can generate single rooms, and those are called breakout rooms, and I can set up the number of the rooms and the duration of those rooms. Those are 1 and 2 in this slide. And then we have the option
to
put them into groups, or we under 5 we can let the users choose their own breakout rooms. And here you see that Big Blue Button is pretty authoritative and hierarchical, but that's okay in this educational situation, because when you have now first semesters and they don't know each other, then I put them into rooms, so the groups mix in different ways, and in other groups I let them self-organize. So I have different variants, and from the point of the teacher, so that makes a lot of sense. So the video tools I'm using, those are for events with the college, and I also use Jitsi, and I get along with that very well, and also BigBlueButton. But BigBlueButton is a tool which is from its structure supporting, or it's applying educational work the best. I can give it to someone other, and things we do normally in the classroom, we can do here very well. Also, yeah, having team meetings in small groups. And that's something I want to put into the discussion. It has to be clear that those video tools cannot replace the real offline teaching. We are happy that with those virtual rooms we can keep the contact to the students, but this is just a help in this time of the pandemic. But in the classroom, we can only teach via audio, so the video has to be turned off because of capacity.
Wo wir dann immer bitten, dass wenn sie zuhören, Video,
so they have to students have to turn off their microphone, only the person speaking can turn it on. The education will be put into smaller pieces.
Langsam reden, das ist eher was ich mir hinter die Ohren schreiben muss, weil ich relativ schnell rede. Dann natürlich
Change of instructions and group
Thema der Themenstellung und der Gruppenarbeit, und dafür ist BigBlueButton gut.
BigBlueButton works very well there.
Und was sich nach diesen zwei Semestern schon, oder was sich auch in den Studien schon belegen lässt, ist, dass wir viel mehr, wenn wir
and what's already been shown in studies when we're using these new tools that we have to use small groups a lot more and handle students individually a lot more, and that it's a lot of work for all of us.
Für uns alle, da es im Sinn asozial ist, und die Lehrer gucken mal über das.
Yeah, so teachers, please don't.
Also kurz und gut, wir sind
check my slides too closely.
Haben die Möglichkeiten, um den Kontakt mit
keeping contact with students is important, but we have to know that it's not a replacement for real life meetings.
Ganz ungewohnt kurz.
So that's it from me so far, and a small hint for those interested, there are technological concepts written up on screen right now, and this is now for the German state of Baden-Württemberg mostly, but it's also a reference for Google and BigBlueButton and other open source programs. But yeah, that's basically it from me for now. We have a few more minutes for questions and are almost back on time.
Super.
Yeah, thanks Rod for your talk. There is a pad for questions. If you have a question, use the pad, feel free. And I'm gonna read a few now, see if we can have answers.
Ansonsten, wenn es keine weiteren Fragen sind,
können wir nochmal offen sagen, wie man an diese.
So maybe let's just repeat how to ask questions. I think that was before the event, but not in the live version yet. Can the herald or the angel maybe help out? Free up the screen again. The angel appears to be missing.
Dieses Fragenpad steht gleich ganz zu Anfang im Chat von unserer Konferenz.
Ja, aber die Leute, die hier zugeschaltet sind, die können.
Ja, so some internal discussion.
Übrigens können die den hören.
Is a chat in the BigBlueButton? That's obviously not accessible from the screen. But whenever you hear a little blip, that is actually this chat. So yeah, people in the screen also should be informed as to how to ask questions. Because in Jitsi and BigBlueButton, this is a very nice feature. There is a chat, and that's a nice thing. But yeah, so please, the Signal Angel should give information again. Maybe in the next round.
Angefunden hat, dann kann da vielleicht einmal in der nächsten Pause eine Info zu geben.
Der Angel hat das gerade intern geschrieben, also
so whoever wants to ask a question can click on chat below the video in the streaming page, and then there is the first link where you can enter an IRC chat, and there the questions will be collected, or you can send them via Twitter or Mastodon, and there we will hopefully see them. Thank you very much.
Super, danke schön.
Okay, so let's go on to Moodle. A lot of teachers probably know it already, and Stefan will talk about it some more. Are you ready?
Stefan, bist du soweit?
Ja, ich bin bereit. Ich schalte.
Yes, I am ready. Let me just share my screen. It should be shared now.
Yeah.
And yeah, seems to work.
Läuft.
Ich sehe von euch aber nur den
Very welcome from my side, Devin Lipke, and I am working as a teacher and teaching teachers in the state of Baden-Württemberg for a few years, also using Moodle, and I'm one of the first ones using it since it started in Baden-Württemberg, basically. And we have an institution with Bellevue that helps schools in Baden-Württemberg, and they host it for the schools, basically. And during Corona, during the crisis, they provided a Moodle for every single school. Some schools had it for years now. And due to that, well, we have a slight advantage, and that's the reason why I am here today, to just give a short overview and to show what I want to talk. Let's just show what I want to talk about. So the basics, the history, technology, and the possibilities of Moodle, a small presentation. And after that, I want to do a live demo to show Moodle from the admin side, what structures are there, what kind of users are there, and different roles, and yeah, possibilities from the side of, from the perspective of a trainer and from the user. So Moodle, the name, what does it actually mean? Many people might not know. It's Modular Object-Oriented Dynamic Learning Environment, so it's an acronym. And in these words, there is basically everything contained what Moodle is able to do. So it's modular, it's object-oriented, it's dynamic, so you can always adjust it, and it's a learning environment. Where does it come from? Well, it was developed in 1999 by Martin Dukiamas in Australia. It was originally made for children in the outback, so they could participate at schools. And it's based on PHP and the database MySQL, Postgres, and so on. And it was originally thought of as a platform used by accessed by a browser, but of course with mobile apps becoming more and more popular, that was included as well. So what options do we have? I have a small overview. The most important thing is probably the virtual classroom, where you can give homework, provide materials, share results, discuss in forums, and even have small tests. I want to come back to these options later on. Of course, it's possible to plan projects and also do projects, so you can really do that stuff in Moodle. But it's also possible to work together with your colleagues, so organize the school using that. So that brings us to the next point, that you can plan your timetables and project your timetables onto the system, whatever that entails. And you can also use it as an archive.
Und natürlich zur Kommunikation,
and for communication, and yeah, so there is still a lot of discussion about this, but we'll come back to that. So that's it for the overview, and now I want to go to the live demonstration in my browser. I have it open in three different browsers.
Ich habe hier das Moodle, mit dem ich in der Lehrerfortbildung die
Anwendungen
immer halte.
Yeah, I'm going to start with that now. In the role of an administrator, I'm already logged in. You can see that in the upper right corner. And up here, every user has their profile in their settings. And usually you always enter at your starting page or dashboard. So the admin has basically access to everything in Moodle, all courses and all parts of the Moodle, but they also have certain tasks. And these we can see here on the left in the website administration, the so-called website administration. And once we access that, we can see further options, further tabs. And here the second one is one of the main tasks, user management. And here the users are separated. It's separated into user profiles where you can add users, put them in groups, and so on. So everything that's connected to that. Of course, all users have their own set of rights and privileges.
So,
basically, users don't come with certain rights or privileges, but you have to give them, apply them to them.
Aufgabe des Administrators, die komplette Nutzerverwaltung. Dann haben wir als nächstes die Kursverwaltung, Kurse und Kursbereiche zu verwalten. Und ich klicke jetzt hier mal kurz rein. Wir schauen uns an, wie so ein Moodle strukturiert sein kann. Standardmäßig kommt ein Kursbereich Verschiedenes, wird automatisch mit installiert bei der Grundinstallation. Und hier habe ich jetzt mal aufgezeigt, wie man das in einer Schule denn strukturieren könnte. Wir haben hier den Unterricht, wir haben das Kollegium und Organisation. Das heißt, das hier wären dann alle Bestandteile drin, bei denen es um Unterricht geht. Und ich habe es hier so aufgebaut.
Yeah, so here you can see that it's always configured according to the school year.
Alle Kurse.
The courses.
Da komme ich gleich drauf.
So this school year would be in this area of the course. So you can structure it very cleanly, and within the courses, these courses would be here. And now I'm choosing the class 5A, for example, and you can see the course over here. We will have a closer look later. And a course has to be imagined like a classroom. And that's how you can imagine this. And here the class can meet up, and you could also add certain topics, and all the materials for the German class, for example, would appear here. And then, of course, you can also add courses here for certain groups of teachers. I didn't show that here, but that would also work. So, a further task of the admin is to also change the design or the what it looks like for each school. You can do it individually. You can upload logos, for example, and change the design by using so-called themes.
So the presentation, now there is the navigation block on the left, or can be on the right, and there can be two column views or something like that. And the last task is also important for the administrator. And that the administrator has to do is to make a backup, of course. You can find it here under the courses, under backup. And so you can make a complete backup of the whole site or the individual courses. And of course, there's also in this administration menu, there's a lot more configuration options that I'm not going to present in detail because of the short time. Let's see how about the time. I think I started at 41, so I'll have a few more minutes. Okay, good. So much about the administration and to about configuration of Moodle. And now I would like to show you in a different browser, show you the trainer role and what the trainer can do. And you can see here, I am signed in as Lehrer Lipke, the teacher Lipke, and here's the class 5A, the course of the class 5A. And if I click on the course, then I am here in this window. I made a little graphic here. This is the course of the class 5A, and there are different subjects that you can choose between different formats. I have the grid layout here. So you have tiles here and can show the different subjects. And and inside, the colleagues upload their material here. And how does this work for a trainer? About in this cog, you can enable the work, enable editing, and then the view changes, and here we have in the trainer view, you can see below the grid, you can see the different subjects, and here about activity or upload material or create material, and can choose what he wants to make available to the students. And here you can see what kinds of activities are there, and this is just a selection of plugins or activities, and there are lots more. But of course, we always have to ask yourself, how much do we really need, and restrict the selection, otherwise it will become far too much and far too complex. As Ralf talked about, this plugin has been activated in Baden-Württemberg. This is Big Blue Button, and you can connect to Big Blue Button servers with that at the beginning of a corona crisis, we had, because of the superhuman effort of some colleagues, which will be presented by another in another talk here. We have now the Big Blue Button servers, and we can connect to the Big Blue Button. Lots of Big Blue Button servers, we can connect to them from Moodle, but there are a few others. For example, here's one for tasks. If there's enough time, I want to show you that in some more detail. And there's something about, there's a feedback module for other flashcards. GeoGebra can be used as a plugin. And there's A5. There are interactive gap tests and multiple choice tests and so on. And to complete the picture, there's also very simple modules that's called work material. And you can just put in a link or just a single file or just a text field and put a comment in a small text field. If you choose that, you will be guided through a configuration wizard, and it shows up here in the area there for the appropriate subject. And so what does it look like in reality? And here I go to the English area. And we see here a small example, listening comprehension. You can see by the symbol, it is a so-called task. And I go into the configuration shortly. And as you can see, it is laid out like this. There's a topic, and you have a short work instruction, and then integrated or attached to the work instruction is a sound file that is pre-recorded, an MP3 file. You can embed this here. And then, of course, you can set the time, at which time and how pupils are supposed to reply, and how they can submit their result, and lots of other setups, which would be too much for the scope of this talk. And if I go back here and deactivate editing. And so I am back in this in the standard view, in the default view. And I would like to switch over to the third browser now and see what it looks like for the students. And here we can see the link to the big blue button, which is also used for many classes as a standard. And here you can enter the individual subjects, and you can see nicely that there is new content here for the English class. And if you click on that, then you get the only a single activity in this case. But if I click on that, then I can see what the teacher has entered here, and your task is to write a summary and hand it in, and you can listen to the student can listen to the sound file, just 3/4 of a minute, and write a short summary and submit it down here. Yeah. So far, that's just a short overview of Moodle, and I don't want to forget to give you some links. These two links here I want to mention, and both of them are demonstration servers in the state of Baden-Württemberg. One is the demonstration server for the education of teachers. And there's a new Moodle demo server, it's called Moodle Move, and you can look at some demonstration courses like the ones I showed you and can play around with it. So much as an overview for Moodle, and I hope I didn't go too much over time, but of course you can ask me questions now or later. Yes, thank you, Stefan, you didn't go over time. No.
Genau, ihr könnt gerne Fragen stellen.
Of course, you can ask questions. Nobody knows exactly how to ask questions. It is below the stream in the chat or at Twitter or in the Fediverse for a certain hashtag, which I just have to look up.
Das war Hashtag RC3.
BHH.
Wenn ich jetzt gerade richtig geschaut habe.
Lena, maybe can help me.
Kannst du mir einmal helfen und den noch einmal raussuchen?
Ja,
RC3 CSH. Right. Genau. C3 CSH. Und
this is a wonderful angel. You can ask all your questions, and we try to answer this. It wasn't really clear how it works with asking questions. So there are some questions for our Big Blue Button.
Ich würde allerdings vorschlagen, die Referenten werden.
So I think the speakers will be available after the talks. So I would suggest to move the questions this at the end, and so we do everything in the end. So we have scheduled 1 hour for exchange of ideas, and so we have some time left to answer all the questions then.
Yeah,
so the quality of the slides is not as perfect, but we had some conversations and tried to get the next slides more sharp so you can see more easily what happens when we click through the software. And so I would move on to Leonard, and I'm really looking forward to the talk of Leonard. So he's a student and speaking for the students. So we this is now about Nextcloud. So from a little bit of different perspective now.
Genau. So, ich gebe dann erstmal.
So, I'm sharing my screen now.
So.
Alright.
So, genau. Und zwar
so, I have prepared something for Nextcloud in schools. So, something to me. I'm Leonard.
Mein Name ist Leonard Entlenkofer. Ich bin
in the
Baden-Württemberg. Das heißt. Ich bin Teil des offiziellen Beratungsgremiums des Kultusministeriums und bin dort auch der Vorsitzende vom Ausschuss Digitalisierung.
So,
sonst bin ich gerade angehender Systemadministrator.
I'm doing my education and I'm in my last year.
Lehrjahr und verwende Nextcloud selbst auch schon.
And I've been using Nextcloud since 2016. So, because I don't have much time, I'll talk a bit faster. If I'm too fast, please someone tell me.
Genau. Und zwar werde ich gleich erstmal die grundlegenden Funktionen.
I'll just show the basic functions of Nextcloud.
Die sich für den Schulbereich laut meiner Erfahrung.
And a few parts that proved themselves, in my experience, to help the students.
Genau,
before we starting the app, maybe the basic functions first. You should be able to see my Nextcloud now. This is a demo Nextcloud I created, and this is the screen you see when you first enter. So you are welcomed. Where it explains itself, what it is, how it works, where you can click through, and you're getting a few nice infos, and then you can enter Nextcloud. They have an overview. So this is the new Nextcloud dashboard, coming with version 20 or something. And here I have all the information that I need. So the overview I would like when I'm first starting it. So I can see my upcoming events. If I have something in my calendar, I'll see it here.
Wenn ich auf Google auf Nextcloud
if I get mentioned or someone's writing me, I'll see that here in the middle and here on the left I see all the files that I worked with last.
Man kann sich das Ganze auch natürlich.
Of course you can modify this and adjust it to your likings. So I can change the background so it looks a bit different, but I'll just stick with the classic blue.
Genau, man kann
you can also
einschalten. Na,
add announcements, but
genau, das war das Dashboard,
more
das
on that later. So this is the dashboard that every user has. And then, basically Nextcloud has been developed as a cloud storage solution, so let's directly start with that. So here is the Nextcloud that everyone knows who ever used it before. So we have the files in a Dropbox or in a OneDrive where I have the files.
Standardmäßig auch immer noch mal eine Nextcloud manual.
And I have the manual where I can see what it should look like. I do think the screen is frozen actually.
Yeah.
As a standard, I have different files here as well. Nextcloud has this nice feature that it can open Office, it can replace Office 365 because it can work together with Office and Collabora. So that's basically LibreOffice online, and I can use such a server, and then I can work with students or pupils and colleagues together, and it looks like this. So I can click on it, and then I can see everything online.
In eine,
and everything is loaded into an online Office version, like we know it from Microsoft Office, but we are actually hosting everything ourselves, and it's GDPR conform. Yes, the screen is frozen actually, so that's not on your end. So we are trying to reset the screen sharing.
Kann ich gerne machen.
Dear viewers, this is not on your end, this is on our end.
Ich habe jetzt jedenfalls gerade die Infos bekommen, man könnte Lennart nicht richtig hören und teilweise auch seinen Bildschirm nicht sehen.
So, the sound is okay, only the screen is frozen. We are still stuck on the start screen.
Könnte das vielleicht damit zusammenhängen, dass du nur dieses eine Bild...
So maybe the, it's not the screen gets shared, but only the window. That could be it, so the dialogues are missing. So we are trying to switch to sharing an entire screen.
Ja, dann haben wir, glaube ich, das Problem, dass meine anderen Bildschirme automatisch mitgeteilt werden.
We are trying to fix that.
Also ich kann... Du auswählen können.
Ah, das hatte ich schon... Nee, ich kann das tatsächlich nicht auswählen. Er zeigt mir leider...
So, the problem with that is that it would share all screens, also, which is not ideal.
Was ich testen kann, wäre, wenn ich den zweiten Bildschirm einfach für die jetzige Zeit...
So, maybe disabling the second screen work. We'll try that.
So machen wir das.
Hier sehen wir gleich mal als Übergang.
So in the interim, one of the main advantages of BigBlueButton for bigger events is that you can share slides as well. But in this case, it wouldn't have helped because this is a live demonstration, anyways.
Mach mal einen Dialog auf.
The screen appears still to be frozen.
Geh noch mal aufs Dashboard. Seht ihr jetzt?
Sorry for the delay.
Soll ich mal meinen Bildschirm teilen?
Das kannst du gerne machen.
Also wir sehen die ganze Zeit noch die Wolken mit dem Start.
Das ist spannend, weil jetzt habe ich gerade gar nichts freigegeben.
Dann ist das vermutlich eingefroren.
Ja, so the screen is still frozen.
Yep.
You are right now witnessing debugging live.
Vorteil allerdings ist dieses...
So, but the advantage is these...
Funktioniert.
These slides are very, very sharp.
Nach wie vor keine
High def.
Also es ist die Nextcloud.
So aber, still no change.
Da bewegt sich nichts.
Also ich habe.
So the calendar should be open now. However, the screen is still frozen. So in the meantime, we are going to switch to a few questions of BigBlueButton.
Das ist eine sehr gute Idee.
Genau, einmal den Browser Cache lernen auch.
Und dann sehen wir dich gleich wieder hier.
Auf jeden Fall. Bis gleich.
So.
Probleme kennen ja alle.
These problems are unknown with all these tools. So let's go to some questions.
Zu BigBlueButton gehen. Jetzt haben wir gerade die Zeit, das zu beantworten.
A question for Ralph. Can a school cheaply host BigBlueButton?
Bin ich zu hören? Bin ich zu hören?
Ja, okay.
Yeah, there are commercial hosts for BigBlueButton that I work with as well as an alternative to the non-existent supply at our school. However, for per classroom, it's about 50 euros a month. That can add up quickly for a school. The other option would be to install a complete server at your school. You would have to talk to your provider, either Bellevue in Baden-Württemberg or another provider. However, you would ideally create a room, so a single processor and so on per classroom. Otherwise, it's too weak. However, you can also rent at a provider. So ideally, it would be Bellevue for law reasons, judicial reasons. So basically, we would need a lawyer for some detailed questions. It should be possible, but so the Digital Pact School is only paying hardware for about up to around 20%. So a small part could be used for hardware. This is now a political project. It's called the question was if that could be used. So is BigBlueButton GDPR conform? It can be. It has to be configured correctly. So if it's hosted in a state server, then the server is physically located in Baden-Württemberg in the state, and it's hosted by the country, by the state. And then the rest is, well, configurable. So it depends on how it's configured. It can be GDPR conform. Ideally, you'd have a good provider as well. And yeah, it is definitely possible to have it GDPR conform. The question is, if you can't see the students, if the cameras turned off, how do you see if they understood? Well, that's one of the big problems of all these softwares, that you don't have direct feedback. So you have to adjust your... first you're giving an overview, and then you are switching to breakout rooms where you will have, where you can have video feeds from the students. So if there was, even if there was enough capacity, you couldn't physically check 24 screens at the same time. If you, you wouldn't be able to properly see the students anyway. So that is a general problem. Links I can also put into the chat here. And the question, the slides could be downloaded. Jessica has the slides already and can hand them on, and I can send them to people.
Und diese Blaupause für Hardware und Software, das ist.
And the blueprint for the hardware and software, that is already in there. The slides for the talks can also be uploaded to digitalcourage.de and be on the Congress page. So hopefully the technical difficulties are solved now, and Stefan can keep talking about Nextcloud. Is that correct? Oh, Leonard, sorry, wrong name. Then he has not solved his problems yet. Ah, he was muted. So, the general, always the same for everyone.
So, dann jetzt.
So, sharing the whole screen now. So, back to the next cloud.
Zurück in die next cloud. Ab wo war ich denn? Hat man nichts mehr gesehen? Up here. Okay.
So, back from the beginning. So here we have an overview, the dashboard, the beautiful dashboard. We have the upcoming tasks, digital classroom, today 12 o'clock. Here we have the talks. Here I'm connected to a test user, started a chat, basically chatting with myself, or chatting with the entire school. And there are no announcements at the moment, but we will change that now. Then the standard function, saving data. In the data storage, there is all the files that we uploaded. That's what Nextcloud was made for. And as mentioned, we can work collaboratively with Collabora or the other software. And this is what it now looks like. We enter a file, a Word file that is in there from the start. Now we wait for a second, and then we have this Office Online that usually, that mostly has the same functionality as the standard Microsoft products.
So I can just start working,
and und wenn ich jetzt das Ganze zum Beispiel von einem
Mitschüler should be proofread by another student, they can use the comment function
und sagen, Kommentar zum Dokument hinzufügen,
and add something to the document.
Deine Überschrift ist etwas langweilig.
And something like, so, the font is kind of boring, or the headline is kind of boring.
Und dann sehen alle hier diese Kommentare, die Zugriff auf diese Datei haben.
And everyone that has access to the file can see that comment. And then there is a chat also for collaborative working.
Gerade auf dieser Datei sind, können hier einfach miteinander chatten.
So the people that are seeing this document at the moment can actually be in direct contact with each other.
Plus meine Nachricht, wie man es von dem Chat kennt, und dann kann man hier zusammen ohne dass man auch
without having to use a phone or anything, any other medium, then you have standard headline settings that you know from other text processing software. You have layout, well, basically more or less what you are used to and what you need. But we don't have to spend too much time on that.
In den Dateien
in the list of files, we cannot just only work collaboratively, but also have our own personal files. There are shared folders, which you see with that symbol, and you know these from other cloud software. So class 1A is something, a folder that I'm a member of, and for example, you have various folders for various school subjects, and you can add things like a presentation in on the subject of German, maybe on Faust, literature subject, and then prepare a presentation together with my co-students. But if I want to share something, not just, not with the whole class, but with a more specific group, then Nextcloud has what they call circles now. And
parallel zu den Servergruppen,
you can create your own
zu den unterschiedlichen
circles here. You, Servergruppen, just to talk about the difference between server groups and circles.
Nextcloud
servers can become groups, but they need, you need an administrator for that.
Sind dann Gruppenzugehörigkeiten machbar.
You have group membership,
and
you would then join standard classes into groups, but maybe I, as a student, would like to work with something just with my friends. I'm not a server admin. And for that, Nextcloud has developed the circles function. I can create a personal circle and call it Faust Presentation. And then I can give that circle a type. I'm making it a personal circle. And add friends to that.
So
starting with letter A, I'm going to add Aaron. And if I would then like to actually work with that circle, I can create a new folder, click on Share,
und hier nach Faust suchen, dann sehe ich, dass hier Faust-Präsentation ist.
Entities to share it with, I can find my circle, not just people and groups. So I can quickly share this circle, this folder with the circle I just created, where I can set my member, the membership myself. groups is something that an admin would have to do. So these are the functions in Nextcloud that are worth knowing. And what makes Nextcloud strong are the various add-ons. Just to talk about two small ones, there is a photo add-on, which will show me all the photos I have in various folders and put it into a gallery, put them in a gallery. I can see my videos as well and sort them by places. I can search for tags. Do various things with the metadata. At the moment, I am in an admin account, which is why I can see everything. I can see the various years in the school and look at certain activities that I want to look at.
So,
if some pupils, students feel like having a bit of fun and want to delete certain folders, I can see who has done what. Right. So that's the activities view. And perhaps one of the best features in Nextcloud is Nextcloud Talk. Nextcloud Talk is its own chat system that runs on WebCloud, uses WebRTC as a technology. And in that, I can speak or chat with everyone. So Adelina, whom I've created, will receive that message. I've created a chat with her, but I can talk to the whole of the school as an admin, distribute some broadcast messages to everyone. No school tomorrow, for example.
So, jetzt sind alle Schüler oder
so,
alle Lehrer
informiert. Now everyone will be informed that there is no school tomorrow and Nextcloud Talk has its own app, which you can use on mobile platforms just like any other messenger. You know them all. And that will give you those messages straight in your device. And I cannot just use Talk in the chat section. I can actually go to a file and click on the three dots icon and start a chat, a Talk chat connected to this file. I can choose with whom I would like to enter this chat that's connected to the file. I could choose some teachers, perhaps. The search ladder isn't that performant, because the server isn't that well suited for that, the one that this Nextcloud runs on. I think I'm just going to chat with Adelina or share it with Adelina. You have that problem all the time with live demos, don't you? I'll reload the page. That often helps with Nextcloud. The advantage is that you will not just encounter the bugs now in the presentation situation, but you can actually learn about the workarounds. So let's go back to the chat
and
start a talk, and I can start talking about the file, and everyone that would like to say something about this file can now butt in, and you can start a video or audio call, which I'm not going to do because I don't want to kill my server, because that actually takes a certain amount of capacity that will affect every page.
But
use a stronger server is the general advice. So I can start a talk like that and simply use, but I can also just use the comment function that you know. I can also share individual files normally.
hier einen Link erstellen.
I can create a link that is public, does not require login. I can choose whether to allow editing, downloading. I can set a password.
Aber das alles
I can time limit the sharing.
Noch, eine
then there is versioning for files in Nextcloud. So if I'm going to change a file or upload it again, then the old version will be automatically saved. How long it stays there you can set, configure in the settings. So there is a nice history of the file and nothing really gets lost.
Genau. Dann
right, so Nextcloud has developed into a groupware during the past years, and we have a calendar function that is can be synchronized via CalDAV, and I can import calendars, and we can copy a CalDAV address into my calendar tool and import that. And we have the different classes here. So we have shared calendars. Every class has its own calendar, and there's a complete calendar for the whole school. And you can see here's the Christmas holidays. And here, for example, you can plan the timetables for each class individually at 7:45, at 12:55. Class 1A is in session, and class 1B, and class 1C. And on Monday, class 1A has classes in the afternoon. And now here's my advent calendar. No, not advent calendar. My timetable. And I can always look at that if I want to. And I can import it to my smartphone. And there are announcements, which is very helpful for teachers who want to say, we are writing a test on Monday, Monday German test, and I can put the topics in here. 1, 2, 3, 4. And there are extended options. Extended options doesn't work. Okay, maybe then normally you would get a selection to which circles I want to share it. And if we don't select any circles and click on announce, then normally it would this announcement would be sent to all Nextcloud users if you have the permissions to do that, because in the settings you can set who is allowed to do that and who doesn't. Let's try that again. Now it works. So you can say to share with class 1A, German test, 1. And announce it. And if we go back to the dashboard, we can see announcements. We can see the new announcement German test a few seconds ago, created by admin. And so the students can see that into their Nextcloud. If they have the Nextcloud app on their smartphone, they will even get a push notification, which is nice. And as a teacher, I can just create this notification and my students will automatically get the information. And then there's the questionnaire tool. Every teacher knows it, and people sometimes use Doodle questionnaires and Doodle. And now I did it for RC3 here, for scheduling, and I have time here, and perhaps I have time here, just like in Doodle, you can do the scheduling, you can do it directly in Nextcloud. And you can add circles to the shared with circles. And let's say I want to share with class 1A, and then automatically it will be sent to all the students in class 1A. They will be sent the link and can reply here when they have time. You can, there are open scheduling or questionnaires or all questionnaires. If there are several of those, if I want to know what's going on. If I don't want to do only scheduling, there's also the possibility to use a form, a Nextcloud form, just like in Google Forms, I can make a form here, make a control checkbox. I will bring something, for example, Nutella and bread.
Brot.
Then the students can, if they get this form, they can select what they want to bring along, and the teacher can see that. And then we really, as you know it, from the maybe on the last day of school before holidays, there may be a breakfast in class, and you can quickly organize who brings what. And of course, on the right side here, you can only share it with certain people. Just put in the name of my class, class 1A, and should be shared with that. And now I just shared with all the class, and I can set an expiry date tomorrow at 5 p.m. I want to have the information. And then after that, you cannot reply any longer. And there are two more nice features, or really only just one nice feature. I can put in external links that will be shown in the next cloud if the permission is set for external links, or maybe they just open a new tab. For example, I can go to the RC3 world, or there may be a direct link to DuckDuckGo. DuckDuckGo doesn't allow embedding, but I left it in. So it's just an example. If an example doesn't, a website doesn't allow embedding, looks like that. So you can just have a. What's also possible if the school doesn't want to use Nextcloud Talk, and you can embed Element and connect it with Element, and here's the start page of Element or Matrix as we know it, and can sign on at your school server and chat that way. There's also a possibility to integrate Big Blue Button, so directly from Nextcloud you can create Big Blue Button rooms, and a Moodle integration is also possible, but I didn't have access to a test server to demonstrate that. But I think my time is up. I didn't look at the clock when I started anew, but I'm mostly through with my content. Yes, thank you very much. Time wasn't really the problem now, but the technical difficulties, as Lena said, they really helped us. So we know we should use Chromium, and we should maybe reload Nextcloud in between if it seems to lock up. Yeah, all right, and it goes on.
We have a tight timetable today. Now it's going to be about Jupiter. Hello. I'll tell something that's mostly for computer science teachings. So with Jupiter Hub, you can have computer science lessons in the browser. So about me, I'm a teacher for computer science at the last few years at a high school, and I have am lucky as I am working at an open source school. So we have LibreOffice, Ubuntu, and everything open source. The motivation of Jupiter. So we had remote school because of COVID, and especially for computer science, that was made this situation difficult because the students did not have the school hardware, but their own hardware with different OSs, and I tried to teach SQL. But the students or pupils failed at installing the Workbench. So after some time, I found Jupiter Hub, that I want to show today, and it offers the option to work in a browser, and they don't have to install anything. So, for who does not want to set up their own server, there is a shortcut here. Julian, who we will talk to, listen to later, he built something here, like an Instagram SQL lernen kann, service where you can learn this. And someone else also created tasks. So for those who don't want the most difficult path possible and don't want to install their own server, there are options. So Jupyter is for people who can set up their own server. Well, you can set up a server with this, and students can then work in the browser and have an all-in-one solution. So I'll demonstrate it for now. So I am on Jupyter Hub now, and I can have these papers, for example, something for SQL. These are tasks. Jupyter Hub is actually made for Python. But I can also, if I load in a module like this, I can also use it for SQL. Da muss ich dann immer mit diesem percent SQL beginnen. Commands. I have to use these percent percent sign, but then yeah, I can then with Control Enter Befehl ausführen und bekomme dann run such a command and we'll get the result from the database. As a teacher, I can easily create these papers or these tasks with Markdown, and you just write down what the students have to do, and they really liked it. So they had the task and the solution all in one, and they didn't have to switch windows all the time. The students really liked that. And that was my example for SQL, and as a standard, we are talking Python here. So I could calculate something here, and with Control Enter, I can run a command, and yeah, I can run Python code here. What's also really nice about this is that you can easily install a plugin called NBGrader, and there you can create courses. So I can enter here, that will enter a new tab. That might be confusing at the beginning. But yeah, I can create these exercise sheets or worksheets with a NBGrader. And there have explanations with pictures, and then I'm writing into the solution sheet. I can also enter the solutions, and I can mark them by begin solution and end solution. And NBGrader takes care that in the student version, this is not in there. So this will not show up in the student version. So we are talking about bugs and error handling before. So in the standard preferences, it crashes quite easily. Then you have to restart the server. This is why I got a connection error, because the server was crashing. So I can write down the solutions and mark them accordingly. And that will result in, well, if I say it should generate or create or compile the course, then the worksheets for the students are also generated, and I can look at them at the preview here. And then I see, so before we had the teacher version, now we have the student version. Now here is your code here, so that has to be deleted by the student, and then they can just try out whatever they want. Yeah, I can also show it from the student perspective. Where is the tab? Here I have a student. I'll just log in as a test student. So, now I can click on assignments and check what did the teacher provide. I can download it as a student. And I can see I got these exercise sheets, can click on them, and now I get the student version.
Und die kann man dann sogar,
and I can also send that back to the teacher, similarly to Moodle, with handing in exercises.
Genau, dann ist noch das Problem.
And yeah, there's still the problem or the challenge that the materials are often in a different format. So there's lesson material here, for example, in PDF format.
PDF-Datei gegeben und eben nicht als so ein Notebook. Und da habe ich hier auf.
And yeah, I started on GitHub to collect documents. So I was translating it or transcribing it into the Jupyter format. So here's the link again to the materials for the State of Baden-Württemberg, where I already started to transcribing it. And yeah. Who likes, who wants to, can just try it at jupyter.sylvialange.de. And yeah, user 01 to user 15. And the password is very secure, it's the username itself, so you can just try it out.
Ja, hier noch ein paar Links. Diese Folien übrigens kann man hier herunterladen. Dann wäre ich mit meinem Vortrag am Ende.
Yeah, so that's it for me.
Sehr schön, danke Silvia. Es kam direkt eine
Frage. So, yeah, there's a question already. So, do you have experience with Java? Nope, I do not.
Habe ich keine
Erfahrung, but I'm pretty certain that it works as well. You probably just have to install a module as well. I've never tested it myself, because right now I'm not teaching Java.
Und noch eine Frage, wie viel Kreativität ist notwendig, dass der Schüler die Lösung ohne Aufgaben durchführen sieht?
I did not get that question, sorry. So can the student hack the system? Can the student
davon gehe ich aus, dass die Frage
so solve the problem without getting the exercises?
Also ich denk mal,
well, I would assume that the student would have to hack my password. And if I have a proper password, no?
Nee.
There is an option, but I do not want to make that one public. So, there might be loopholes. If someone's very clever, there are options. But that's in every software the problem, basically. Where are the borders, or what are the limits of the software? And how smart can students get and find loopholes and get information they shouldn't actually have? But as we know, all know, are these moments where you learn the most. So basically, I really like those questions. Because the creativity in this spot, well, it should be too easy, so the students really learn something. So you should learn more by finding a loophole than by doing the homework, not the other way around. Yeah, so those are the questions I got so far.
Dann geht es jetzt weiter mit einem
so, we will continue with Freifunk at school, so free networking.
Wenn wir unsere ganzen Programme nicht ans Netz kriegen, dann war es doch sowieso mit
and because if we don't get proper internet, the distant lessons or the remote lessons will not work anyways.
Ja, ich bin soweit. Kann man mich hören?
Sound is working, the slides are visible, everything is great.
Hervorragend.
Yeah, happy to be here.
Ich freue mich sehr, dass ich da sein darf heute.
And I wrote an experience as a starting point for your thoughts.
Umfang von 15 Minuten bei weitem. Deswegen möchte ich nur einen kleinen Einblick geben. Zunächst mal zu mir und zur Schule und zu
den so first to the school and the students. I am a teacher in the city of Mössingen. That's southern of Stuttgart, as most of you might be able to hear at the dialect. We have four classes per grade, that's around 750 students and 90 teachers. And here we can see the club, students from 2019. This year we did have some actions actually and some projects, but I didn't have any pictures. So 10 to 15 students from grade 8 online upwards are working in this club, and we will get to what they are doing later. So I am Frank Schiebel, I'm teaching math, physics, I studied that, but of course I can teach other things where there is no teacher available. So computer science basically. What is free Freifunk? So free radio basically.
Weil das auch nicht vielleicht jeder immer sofort auf dem Schirm hat.
So not everyone might know what it is. It's a community network where you are setting up Wi-Fi routers to make internet available.
Diese WLAN-Route, die verwenden eine Infrastruktur.
And it takes infrastructure from the Freifunk communities and make it available via private routers that are connected via VPN to the internet and to the network.
Alle Geräte, die sich mit diesem Freifunknetzwerk verbinden, wenn sie ins Internet wollen, über das Gateway des Freifunks.
So, if people want to use the Freifunk Gateway, you have the problem of provider liability, you don't have that anymore. I'm not going to go into further details, but just to say that Freifunk is a network on its own, but most people just use it to get access to the wider internet. Now, the most relevant items are that it is open and free, which means that you don't need any access data to connect. If you see a Freifunk router advertised anywhere, then you just use your settings and you will notice that it is an unencrypted, unauthenticated network, which you can use straight away. Now, what has to be said fundamentally is, and which is relevant for me as a teacher, is, well, about letting go is how I titled this slide, because this is a somewhat philosophical question. We see this range here, from left to right. On the left you have absolute control by the teaching person, and on the right you have total self-control on the side of the students. And of course, in reality you are somewhere on that scale, at any point of that scale, it won't work to use the position on the far right, not meant politically, and the far left position of teacher control is what many people might be tempted to use. So I've something that might illustrate that is the notes I took in, I'm showing in the bottom half of that slide. I tend to drift towards stronger self-control by the students, and the way I teach is infused by that. Do I want to control when students may access the Wi-Fi is one question, or am I happy with them always having that access? If I wonder whether to install Freifunk at my school, my conclusion has to be that I don't really mind if students use their private devices to connect in the lesson, during the lesson. In 2015, the situation was for me that we had a few access points in teachers' rooms in the schools, allowing teachers to use the internet. In principle, we knew that in our school we would like to have internet access everywhere, which led to technical problems. First, there weren't cables in all the rooms, which led me, as someone who knew Freifunk, to supply the whole building with a mesh network, and that meant that people had Freifunk access, which the students liked. And we were then wondering, how can we really roll out Wi-Fi to the whole of the school, and do you want to stay with Freifunk for that? And there are a few basic questions to consider. You know, there is context. For example, there are privacy implications, there are regulations, administrative ones. The federal state of Baden-Württemberg actually prohibits teachers' devices that can contain personal data on students to be connected to open Wi-Fi networks. So it was clear from the start that two Wi-Fi networks would be needed, one for the teachers and another, which could be Freifunk or something else, for the students. And the basic question then was, should students have access at every time, or should it require a permission that would be given and withdrawn at certain times? And the answer was quickly found that there should be all-time access. Then the question was, do we need a filter to protect them from certain content? And you have to say, I know quite certainly that various German federal states deal with this in different ways. In Baden-Württemberg, we found, by asking the district government, that a filter would not be mandatory. There should be measures for prevention, which we had by, I didn't quite get what the measures were, but probably there were people to talk to. Another question, if you want to know, the question was, how do we manage the access points? Once you have about 50 of them, there is a problem there, and we opted for Unify to solve that. But the aim clearly was to get the students, to give the students all-time access with their own devices too, with their private devices that they would bring, so that we as teachers would not have anything to deal with there. And about the formalities, the question was, how do I get the necessary permission to install such a network? I have to go through the school committees. There is the teachers' conference and the general conference, which consists of the head of the school, teachers, parents, and students, the general conference. And optionally, I don't think this is a rule in our federal state, we also went to the elected parents' representatives at the beginning of the school year and introduced a concept to them. And because of the filtering, we looked at the regulations and asked the district government to verify that filtering would not be necessary. All the committees agreed, and some funding was available too, so that gave us Wi-Fi. And the way we explained this, I'd like to introduce that to you. The essential point was, at the beginning of the debate, was, well, students, the worry was always, well, people can now access the internet in an uncontrolled way. And the way we argued was to say that, well, we have these green networks now that are administered by us. It's for us to control who will get access. And then there is this other area that is always available, that's mobile internet, which students have on their private devices anyway. And the problem with that is that that is expensive. That is still the case. Discount offers normally come with relatively bad internet access, so you would normally need real subscriptions, real contracts, which is expensive. And our argument was that we will use a free and citizen-controlled network instead and give them that. And that really was something everyone could understand and agree with quite quickly. since 2016 now we have Freifunk at our school and more, which I'm going to talk about. Technically, what we did was, if any Freifunkers are present, the SSID is Freifunk as normal, there is no access restriction. The whole thing runs over a virtual LAN and arrives at an offloader that uses the school's internet connection as a gateway, and they connect to Freifunk of the Freiburg region, and that gives you an effective bandwidth of about 100 megabit, symmetrical bandwidth, it has to be said. We are fairly happy. We have a fortunate situation because we have a fiber connection to our school which has symmetric bandwidth, so nothing's really taken away. And everyone can access the net all the time. There is no management effort. It all works quite well so far. And I'm now going to take a deep breath, because that, in principle, was the official part of it. At a public school, you can have this kind of network access. You have about 300 to 400 devices connected on a normal day, so about 2/3 of all the students have a device. And as a side remark, we actually have a mobile phone prohibition in place. Devices can be used, but only for the occasions defined by teachers. So it's not like students are now sitting around in the corridors and staring at their phones all the time. This is used in lessons prompted by the teacher. A further thing that I took away from that discussion, I was surprised that many students really asked me whether they could simply access that internet. That has stopped by now because a new normality was established. But before that, what they were used to was having to sign agreements saying that the school could see where I surf to as a student. So it was unusual for them to have this free kind of access. Second takeaway was that parents don't really know a lot about what the devices can do, the devices that their students, that their children have in their pockets. So parents might say, I'm not giving a SIM card to my child to prevent them from having access. So it was a surprise for them to learn how it works. And interestingly, there was no debate about radiation that you often get when Wi-Fi is being talked about. You hear that as a worry quite often, but we didn't have that. There is a conspiracy theorist now that would like to kind of have that debate in retrospect, but it's not really a worry for now. So there is a working group on Freifunk that was established now that the foundations were laid. So students were introduced to Freifunk in 2016, as I said, and in the term of 2016 and 2017, the refugee person in the community asked whether a refugee residency could be supplied through us, or could be supplied with Freifunk. And that led a working group to form, which looked at the situation and saw whether they could help out this residency. There's an 800 meter distance from the building to the building that you see in the background. So we built a radio link using 841 TP-Link devices, and they did use the school's line then to get connected to the internet. That was a lot of fun. Two computer science courses were involved. There was good media coverage, which we were happy about. And then the students asked, what now? And I said, well, we're finished. It works. It updates automatically. And yeah, well, we then thought we could do a bit more, maybe. And at that point, I have to fast forward, because we are nearing the end of our time.
Dann gab's längere Gespräche mit der Stadt.
We had extended talks with the community, the municipality, and they came on board eventually. And by now, in the community of Mössingen, this is the situation we have. You see the school in the lower right, you have the town hall, more refugee residencies, pensioners' homes are connected now. There is a place, an open meeting place. So we got the city on board, the community, and we did get more groups on board. And the working group of our school was given more work to network more places in the city. Right. So this is the summary. We have a nice backbone in the community of Mössingen. We've supplied the public pool, the town library. We have a mobile home park. We have the railway station square. And the working group actually has a say in who should next get supplied. We have a kind of waiting list. And of course, Corona kind of stopped us in our tracks. We networked the railway station square at a time that was allowed by the infection numbers, but at the moment we're lying low. Right, that's it. My conclusion is that without any huge problems, it worked and it's operating very, very well. Of course, there may be other schools in other regions where with the students there, it may not work that well. It worked very well for us. Working with that students working group takes a lot of effort, but it's fun. And my takeaway is, as Jessica said in the introduction, if you do things yourself in school, that is not just bad. There's a lot to learn, not just for teachers, but for students too. And it kind of radiates out into the community. That's something that should not be underestimated. And for completeness, I have to thank the students, first of all, which have become the Freifunk Group of Mössingen, effectively, and then Freifunk in the Freiburg region of Dreiländereck, the three countries region. I would like to mention Freifunk Stuttgart and the city of Mössingen, who actually have a budget position for us now. They've been giving us great support. If there are questions, you can ask via Mastodon. The slides are in GitHub, and there is a place I've seen that Jessica has provided to collect the materials. Right. That gets me to the end of my talk.
Super. Yes, thank you very much, Frank. That was exactly in time. It was exactly 15 minutes, and you didn't have to hurry that much. But I was thinking about maybe we should have done Freifunk earlier, because there were several very important, great information in it. But I think there are still a lot of people in the stream. I've seen that the stream is maybe problematic in some cases. I hope not too many people are affected. Frank, your audio is still on, if you could turn it off. What I wanted to say here is what I find great is that you can do projects with students in workshops or in working groups, and that is really exactly what I meant with sustainable learning, that not just teach pre-prepared content, but work together with the students and keep them interested. And I find that is a really, really good idea. Yeah, of course. Yeah, yes. My question is to Oliver. Are you ready for your presentation? We are a little bit early, 3 minutes early, but Oliver will present a project, which means we go away from what already is there, but look at what could be there. And that's very interesting as well. Okay. Can you hear me? Your screen? Can you see my screen? We can see the screen. Yes. Mm-hmm. All right. We have a very nice introduction. What about creating stuff ourselves? Why is it a good idea? Because exactly, that's exactly where we are going to go. Because all the topics that we had before, that Moodle, Nextcloud, Jupyter, BigBlueButton perhaps as well, we heard about working on documents with Collabora inside Nextcloud. All this requires servers. In IRC, I've seen someone has written, all right, yeah, such a server, that's maybe it's asking too much of it, but if it's more than a USB stick, it's a problem. But if we want to make our own tools, we have to do it ourselves. And this is our theme here. It was called the Virus Hackathon. In March, was about how to do it ourselves. Maybe, who am I? Why do I talk about this, even though I'm not a teacher? I studied business computer science in the automotive industry, work in the area of digital factory, but I'm very interested in open source and privacy, and I always attach public keys to my emails, and in the communication with digital courage, it was the first time in years that I could send an encrypted email. That was really great. So I'm working on this and was interested in school projects, because if we're doing open source and if we teach the how to treat software, and then we have to start with the schools, and especially the time that we have now is currently is, of course, well, they do all do Microsoft 365 because it is so easy, but you have to make sure that you know that if you don't have the control over your data, that there are certain risks. And it's the direction of my project. Maybe I can show the links in the end, what it was about at the hackathon. My little part was this digital project that I'm going to show you. And because we found that there are lots and lots of tools. We saw that Jupyter, Nextcloud, Moodle, and Jupyter as an e-learning platform. And there are so many tools you can use, and how could it be that someone thinks Microsoft 365 what a good idea to use at schools? And what has been awarded with a Big Brother Award by Digital Courage, and what can we do about it? How can we do it? And that's the direction I'm going. And how can you do it to at school perhaps, and have it run by a provider perhaps as well? So what's Ilias? This is an example that we have chosen, because it's an established and widespread e-learning platform that is used at universities, and at many universities, with it has lots of features. It's similar to Moodle, maybe. You can do a lot with it. And all these tools, you can host them yourself, or you can use a professional hosting service, which costs money, of course. And then we get into the area, how do you do it? We have a big budget for digitalization at schools, but you can't use it for everything. Maybe there's doing it yourself is maybe the right answer to the question sometimes. So what was the result of the hackathon? And I'll show you. Let's see if that works. Okay, let me show it to you. Here, there are YouTube videos from the hackathon, and you can watch them and you can share them. What has happened there? There's a demonstration, how that works. We can look at that if nothing else works. And there's a GitHub project where you can find the source code that has been created during that hackathon. Okay, so if you want to self-host our project and we need a server, that's clear, of course. What do you need to do? We need a web server, we need an SSL certificate, so the browser shows that it is encrypted. And you need to do a lot, but once you have done it by hand, there's a lot to do, really. And with the technology Docker, I don't want to go too deep because some teachers will be listening, but even then you need to do it manually quite a lot. But the goal is to make it as easy as possible. So there's an auxiliary script to configure Ilias, and you can download it from this GitHub project here, and you can see you only need need a little bit of knowledge how that works. Without knowledge, you can't really do it. But if you have it on the server and you have a domain that points to the server, then it's very easy to configure and start. And of course, this has been done with Ilias. Of course, you could do it with other tools and extend it. Let's take an example. This is an Ilias installation. And if you configure something from scratch, then you this wizard will guide you through the installation of this environment. There's a school client from Ilias that is simplified a little bit and is reduced, restricted to certain features. And there's a default installation that can do everything. I'll do the default installation. And then perhaps you have a server that you can host several instances for the schools on that. Now I have the domain tigerbeetle.de. Let's use alias 1, tigerbeetle.de. And Ilias 2 on the same domain. And I configure those. And you, now it shows the configuration that it's going to move, what does it look like, and you can just start the configuration, and then the project is configured and is ready and could be started. Let's see if that really works. A lot of stuff is working in the background, is happening in the background. Several Docker containers will be started that you can find in open source projects, and they will be downloaded and installed. And this was already cached, so it was very fast now. But in the background, everything is being started, and SSL certificates will be requested, so everything looks correct in the browser. Oh, my stream seems to have stopped.
Gibt es da zwei Konfigurationen, von der man sich jetzt
now die can look at the log files. Anschaut,
um an das erste Passwort ranzukommen?
Yeah, it's back. And I can briefly show that it is already running in the browser. Okay, so some more. The database is being started, and there's a root password. You can see it here in the new installation, but of course you have to delete it and change it. But now we should be able to find an Ilias installation on Ilias 1 Tiger Beetle. This doesn't work at the moment. It can happen in a live demonstration. It's sometimes a bit difficult. So let's see how I configured it. It's ilias1.tigerbeetle.de. Doesn't currently work. That's the effect you often have in presentations. It's quite a risk to do it like that. It worked yesterday. And if you ask for these certificates too many times, maybe the certificate wasn't handed out. But we can maybe look at it in the video, how it how it's supposed to look. Let's try it again, maybe.
Nicht läuft es, ich weiß nicht genau.
No, I don't know. I don't know exactly what went wrong. You can see that it requests the certificates, and why it didn't start, I would really have to look. It's not in productive use anywhere. It's a hackathon project that has been developed just recently, but now it works, and suddenly we have a working Ilias instance. Normally it's a lot more work, but everyone who has set up such a server knows that it's a lot of work. But it's very helpful if you have these scripts that simplify it a lot. And there's a complete Ilias platform, has lots and lots of features that I can't show you all of them, but it's rather about how to host it yourselves. And this is more or less the end of the presentation. And now we could go to the Q&A session. I should add that ILIAS is a platform, an education platform, a learning platform that has been used at universities and colleges. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe during the Corona pandemic, there was an action to bring ILIAS to schools, and there's a template for schools now, and lots of support from the ILIAS community for schools. And as far as I know, it has been in test installations at schools, and there are lots of things you can do with it for schools. And I currently have no question about the presentation. If maybe there are questions, that's not a problem. We can do that at the end, and we have another short presentation. So you are done with your presentation. Yeah, if there are no more questions and the questions, well, it's not so much for teachers, this presentation, maybe except computer science teachers, maybe, but you can talk to me afterwards if you maybe are interested in using it. Okay, yes, thank you very much. So I didn't interrupt you. Okay. So we have another short presentation about Schulverwalter, about the software, and we put it at the end intentionally, and it's a bit shorter than the others because Schulverwalter is not open source.
We thought, should we present it nevertheless or not? But if that there's no data secure alternative to this software, we thought we do an exception. Although it's not free, we will present it here. So I'm giving the word to Julian. Hi. Thank you for the explanation. I have shared my screen now.
Kann man den schon sehen?
Can you see it? Yes.
Fantastisch. Also,
I want to talk about digital school administration. So how can you communicate with students? I rather focus on the perspective of teachers. So I'm from Leipzig. That's where you would all would like to be if there's no pandemic. So I'm working at the school as a teacher. So why would you want to digitalize a school? Maybe I don't have to explain that too much. So a lot of teachers have to share one book to put something in, or they wonder if a student is present or sick. And so there's a lot of effort, and that's the time slacking to deal with and work with students. So you think about why would you do digitalization, and if you look at the market, so then you see not a lot of publishers who have, so, and the software is pretty old. And if I have a software, that's a screenshot of an example, then you have a lot of possibilities. As a not technique savvy person is overwhelmed, and I'm asked things I don't know or I don't have to know. So then it's not working, so school saying, let's switch back to paper. So I was desperate, and I thought that's not the way it should work.
So
I have with two friends who are teachers and from university. We want to show that this works. So I want to show the teachers from you and the computer scientists. I want to encourage to be engaged and involved, because if there are more of us, then the teachers have more time to be at school and not to take care of administration. So we were asking, where's the most of the work? I have to know a lot around school, so if the children are sick. And we asked ourselves, are we allowed to do that? That's not easy to answer. And when we knew that we are able to digitalize and allowed to, then we thought about the great book to start. So what we learned to digitalize this. You have to build the digital program the way that analog looks like. So somebody who doesn't know technology, they have to say, I know this concept, it's just on the screen and I can use that. So that's a digital notebook. It looks the same as in analog version. And if I develop further, I can see summaries what you can see in the analog version. What we learned is you shouldn't start installing software in school. Sometimes it's not working at all, or the updates are only rolled out in summer. And that's embarrassing, and features are missing. So that's why we have included the print of the results in the browser. The second thing we learned, students don't have a PC like we have. They oftentimes only have a smartphone, especially in poorer families, and also families who are not that tech-savvy. Then parents don't have a device with a big screen, so we thought we have to do something mobile first, so we published an app for Android and iOS. So how do you introduce this successfully without any rolling back after a while? So first of all, you have to choose a test group. So then you overlook something, you see sport teachers need something else afterwards. You have to do workshops. So you teach everything to the students and also the teachers. And the most important is having office hours. So the teachers, when they have to overlook children and students, then it's different. You sit in the room and somebody can get in, either a student or a teacher, and they can ask me questions, where is the Wi-Fi cable, or I need a password, or I have a question for this and this. That's a way you can introduce it very well. So only introduce one software at a time and really think about documentation. We have made the experience videos are best, and that is similar to a teacher. That's why, because somebody is explaining something, but we also wrote a doku. And so then we need to spend less time with support and can focus on work. If you say this is interesting, or I would like to see more technical details, but you can write me. I'm in IRC. You can find the link to my profile. My Twitter account is wi_wissen, and there's the website schulverwalter.de. Yeah, thank you. That was my input. And I'm looking forward to the questions and answers. Great, thank you, Julian. So I said Julian has organized a teacher desk. That's nothing we have had now, but I see there are some questions left to Moodle. But you can spend the remaining time to ask more questions with Twitter or in the chat window below the stream. And Angel will forward those questions to us so we can answer them. And I'm Stefan will now talk.
Dass es so viele Fragen zum Moodle gibt, liegt auch darin, dass es eben
A lot of schools already use Moodle, and there's one question to Stefan. Which plugin nutzt ihr, you use to create audio already in Moodle and use it for review feedback? Yes, I have looked at the questions already.
teilweise die schon im Moodle-Support mehrfach beantwortet. Also das Audio the, direkt geht...
The audio is using the Record IRC plugin. So it's coming from the Big Blue Button people. And that's something you can build into Atom and also Tiny MCE editor. And if you give the option to online to text input, then the people can click on the symbol, a microphone symbol, and can record. I have gotten the feedback that this is not working in all browsers really stable. I don't know where what the reason for that is.
Konnte ich bisher noch nicht ausfinden.
Does this answer the questions? We think yes. Yeah, the person cannot give feedback if the question is answered, but that's a good hint. The next question is about the Moodle app, which is not suitable for administration of Moodle, and is there anybody working on that? The Moodle app is only for the users of for teachers and trainers. And honestly, from my experience as an admin, I didn't want to administer Moodle on a mobile device. It would be too complicated. Maybe on a tablet, but the possibilities and options to configure are so many
that
I prefer to have two monitors and work this way.
Also von daher wüsste ich nicht, dass daran gearbeitet wird, dass man.
And doing the administration over the app, I don't see that working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm just checking the other questions. Something about Big Blue Button, but that comes later. Is that also in Moodle? Yeah, I also think makes sense to call it directly from Moodle, just to minimize the number of screens. So how can you combine Big Blue Button and Moodle? So in Baden-Württemberg we have those combined. I actually showed that in the demo, that the activity a plugin for Big Blue Button exists, and you can just use it as any other plugin for activities directly in Moodle. So if you wanted to know if all the functionality of Big Blue Button runs directly on the Moodle server, in our state it's on a different location, so it's not hosted on the same server, but it's called directly from the Moodle server. So when you click on it, Big Blue Button directly starts, and you then are on the Big Blue Button server. I hope that answers the question, or I hope I got the question correctly. But as mentioned, for me the main advantage is that with the children you don't have to say, yeah, if we have a conference you go there, and if we have lessons you go there, but it's all in the same, you start at the same portal basically. Yeah, that was a nice answer. a sufficient answer.
Dann haben wir hier noch eine Frage. Ganz oft
yeah, often there are nice ideas for plugins and extensions. How can we structure the creation of these? Maybe you have an answer. Yeah, so in Bernwoodbeck we have the same problem. We have two functionalities that we really wanted to have. So, the original UberConf plugin that uses a cron job and can transfer different file formats into PDF, and PDFs you can edit PDFs directly online in BigBlueButton and make notes and give feedback into the PDF. So we had this problem in Baden-Württemberg, and due to security concerns, we couldn't use the original UnoConf. So we gave out a contract paid by the state. And I think that was a local company, and we gave them a contract. And in the next version, the 3.9.3 plus version should be published before the 9th. So, yeah, how can we contribute when it's about Moodle? The first step would be to go to moodle.org and check the plugins. Is there maybe something similar? Or something that works in the same direction or is created in the same area, and then maybe use that and talk to those developers and maybe create a ticket to suggest the new functionality. And then you can talk to those developers, or maybe they will talk to you, and then yeah, you have to discuss it and see what they can do. What maybe you can give as a financial incentive, so the functionality is added. Yeah, great.
Super.
I think those were all the questions to Moodle. There is one more that is more general. Why are you always only... why are you not checking iSurf? As far as I know, a lot of states are using it. Yeah, that's correct. The answer is very simple. We were asking openly who wants to talk about what software, and we didn't tell people what to talk about, and nobody wanted to talk about iSurf. But as soon as we get information to iSurf, what to keep in mind when using it, then of course at Digital Courage on our webpage we will publish information. I think right now there is no information on that, but we already asked for information. Other than that, there are a few more questions for Julian. First of all, why did you decide on creating a closed source software? Do you want to defend yourself?
Nein, also ich wollte eher sagen, also ich traue mich noch nicht. Also grundsätzlich finde ich
I don't dare doing open source yet. Ich fand mich I really like it, and I already found open documentation revolutionary, because nobody really does it. And you really have to know that when talking to schools, you have to have a framework, a legal framework. And I really invested a lot of money in that already, so I would like to break even, I have to say. If someone has an idea, and I know that it's technically possible, and someone can convince me from towards open source, I would consider it.
Ja, das sind doch gute Aussichten. Es wird hier jetzt gerade
in yeah, in the chat, people are also mentioning that there is the software Alexis, Alec with K and then SIS, that exists as a free and open data data private software alternative. Maybe that's also something to check out. And other than that, I would actually close this round for now if there are no more questions. In the chat, we definitely can stay online. We have a few more minutes. So whoever is joined via Jitsi can definitely stay a little bit longer. We are also accepting further questions. And for the speakers, please add the most important links from your slides to the pad, so we can also publish them on our website, and the presentations will also be uploaded there if we are allowed to do that. And the link can also, for the impatient ones, mention here. I chose something that can be read. It's called pet.fürbut.org. Fürbut, that's the old name of Digital Courage. So it's pet.foebud. So foebud.org/digitales Klassenzimmer. That's digital classroom. That's digital classroom in German. But it will also be RC3 page. So I would like to put a stop point here and thank all the speakers for participating. And in the shop there were a few orders already, and because today is a work day, they already getting packed, and we are happy about that, because our problem is that when we are running such a campaign about education, we have the problem that education is a local problem in Germany. And as a small organization from the city of Bielefeld, we are running into the problem that people are online and clicking close and far, and share, so they can download it and order a physical copy and share it, and also bring it into their local communities. So that is the good thing about online. We don't have to go into all the local communities, but other people can do it, and the further it spreads, the better. And of course we are happy about feedback. We already got a lot about the content. Yeah, I can mention some numbers. I don't know the latest numbers, but we already sent out over 600 packets, educational packets. So many schools are happy to receive them. 600 is a good number, but there is 32,000 schools, so there's still a lot to do. So we are happy about all how we can get. So yeah, we are also happy about donations, so we can afford to send out these packets. And also, I mean, these can be sent in a digital form via email. That's the easiest and cheapest way. And the same as we, just as we had school addresses, we already sent them out ourselves. But you can imagine that when it comes from a parent or from a teacher who's working there, and you could also just print out the PDF, some people need things on their desk, then it's of course a different thing that when something comes like spam from somewhere and you get it via email, and you don't even know what do you want from me. So yeah, it's worth more when people bring it in, whichever way. So you can of course click together the components yourself, but it's more expensive than just getting the packets
sondern
the pre-configured packets, so it's not for us to get rich, but to have optimal packets.
Ja, ganz genau.
And to make it easier. And yeah, it needs the power of the many hearts who help and take part in it. And I'm always happy whenever there is an event about this, that people are really interested in it. So thank you very much to all the people who are here in this room and also the ones who help, who are watching in the stream. And this dialogue is actually just beginning. And we're hoping that we can just do our part and that it gets easier for people, because there's a lot of people who don't know anything yet, but who want to get started and to want to participate and to give these people a starting point. Yeah, I also want to say thanks again to all the speakers, because it was really a lot and it was quite fast, but I really got a lot of feedback and it was really nice. There were a lot of topics and it was a nice event. And even though we couldn't talk face to face, as it would have been in a normal workshop, we definitely did our best. And yeah, you more or less know who was talking. We were showing the list in the beginning, who was talking about what topic. And yeah, we can show that again. So if you have a specific question, you can definitely talk to them via other channels, either via me and Digital Courage, Digital Courage. And yeah, Lena, do you want to add something? No, I think we mentioned everything important. There is, of course, a lot more to discuss and a lot more to tell. However, we don't have the ideal space for that right now. But of course, there is always the option to find together, to group together in smaller groups. And I always also put in the email addresses in the Etherpad, so feel free to contact us during the Congress and maybe we can create a smaller discussion or workshop round. And for us it was important here to not always say, yeah, use free software and there's so much, but also to give specific examples, to show the software, to demonstrate that it works and to reduce the hesitance maybe. And yeah, I hope that we could also make a small step for mankind to help all of us forward. And we were already mentioning in the beginning the work group pedagogy. Yeah, so we have a small hurdle, a starting hurdle, but yeah, so some of us
So
they can also contact us. So that's a different level, but also to think about how could educational concept look like and what you can do to bring this more to visibility, this topic that's on our website for children and young adults. There are some links, and then you find the working group for education. Last note from me, that's something which was raised in our chat. So there are a lot of speakers from Baden-Württemberg, and that is by chance. Maybe in those circles I was asking more about speakers. There's something going on with Microsoft in Baden-Württemberg. So by the minister, a pilot project was started to bring Microsoft software to a lot of schools, and a lot of people got together there, and they are actively fighting against this happening in their federal country. And that's why a lot of people are active from this region. So I hope at the next Congress, we will have a very versatile group from all different states, so who are being active against proprietary software. So that would be what I like to see next year. So I wish you a happy new year. And if you like, you can stay here in the Jitsi room, and I will be here for a little longer. And yeah, otherwise, we see each other at the next Congress or somewhere else. Bye.
Tschüss.